So if we think about tooling in general, first tools that were developed when we were basically running naked, our instances were running naked, was 3 million years ago, which is a lot of history. So I want to start our journey with tooling with simple reminding ourselves what the tool is, which is a physical item that can be used to achieve a certain goal, and in our technology slash software context, it's a process or procedure that is serving a specific purpose. So right now, in our present times, we have a lot of tools that are available in our hands, and they're bound to make our lives easier and tasks completed faster. The real question is, do they really do that for us? How we determine which ones are good for us, and especially in software, and every single day we have so many open source projects, frameworks, and tools available at hand. Nowadays, we keep assigning empowerment to the choice of tools and utilities for our workflows. But it's not necessarily tools that make us so powerful. It's our skill. And I really want to quote Paul Jarvis from his book, The Good Creative, here. If a carpenter loses his nail gun and has to use a hammer, it doesn't become less skilled. A programmer doesn't forget how to code if she switches computers or even programming applications. A writer's stories are no less valid because he changed from black to blue ink. Creatives aren't good at their art because of their tools. Their talent stems from the skills and knowledge they've acquired while using their tools. So naturally, if we think about tooling, tools have a decent amount of influence over our speed and quality of our operations. But still, the question remains, how we define which ones are necessary for us and which ones are bringing more value than actual harm. So since we are trying to determine which tools are subjectively the right toolkit for ourselves and our teams, I want to talk about something that appears in discussions about software and design very often, which is simplicity and complexity. So one thing about simplicity, by nature, it's very subjective because we can observe two types of it. Simplicity that's visual, so when we look at things and we say, oh, this looks very simple. And operational simplicity, which is actually simplicity that we can determine when you're using a certain item. So when we're trying to define simplicity, we could say that in a way it equals sanity. Especially if we're talking about technology. And why? Because at the end of the day, the technology that's at our hand, it's supposed to enrich our lives. But on the other hand, there's just so much software and so much tools that it can make us feel very kind of like uncomfortably full. So we live in superabundance of information, and the most crucial skill is not multitasking, but single-threading our attention. Because we are overwhelmed, not only with tooling, but the amount of information that's possible for us to consume. And it's sometimes impossible to handle. We just want to learn it all. We want to like know all the new features, not new CSS features, new JavaScript features, and like it's just too much to handle. And it can often lead to burnout and imposter syndrome because we just can't digest it all. The strive for simplicity is so superficial. And why? Because we want simplicity all the time. Everyone says that, like, I want things to just be simple. But we don't really have usually the deeper understanding of why things are complex and why we're confused or we're irritated because something is not simpler. So by default, we think that if we just make it simpler, automatically we're getting rid of our frustration. But we don't that's not necessarily true. Because we fail to notice that complexity is a necessary ingredient for our rich and eventful life. So it's like it coexists with simplicity. Complexity is a fact of the world, simplicity is in the mind, as Don Norman says it in his great book, Living with Complexity. So we want to be more capable. We want to be more empowered with devices and tools that are available for us. The need for more features is forever present, but it also lives in parallel with our need to have easy and nice interfaces and good usability and having understandable interfaces. When we think about defining complexity then, we can say that complexity means how much time it takes to learn a certain item.
or how much information I have to digest to understand how something works. So it actually resides in our understanding of how things work. So we as humans create conceptual modules that portray how physical objects operate. And we tend to forget very often that by default, we accept very complex solutions in our daily lives all the time. And complexity is a constant in our lives. So when we think about it, and when we decrease user-facing complexity, it certainly will rise somewhere else, usually on the back end. Which is why I want to bring up the Tesla's law of conservation of simplicity. Every application has an inherent amount of irreducible complexity. The only question is who will have to deal with it? Me as a developer or the users? So tools are built to save our time. And savings in time feel like simplicity. So that's one of many reasons why Node is so popular and why Node is so approachable, because it's faster. So speed of use and speed of underlying V8 is so great because you're saving time. And there's an implicit benefit in good tooling and automation being saving us in time that you can use to do whatever else that you want to do, like develop another project or just rest. So since we are talking about tooling, we talked about simplicity and complexity and automation, then there's the topic of automation, and which is especially important for front-end right now. So most of you probably are using preprocessors such as SAS, LESS, or Stylus, or post-processors such as Myth, interpolating engines such as Jade or Ham. So you're bound to watch files and rerun tasks and builds. You probably care about performance, so there are another set of tasks such as minification, image optimization, file concatenation, which is another set of processes that possibly should be automated, so you don't have to worry about it. So we have this set of tasks that should be automated to stay productive, so we can focus on problem solving that just cannot be simply usually delegated to machines. So I want to focus on some tools that for some of you might be familiar, for some of you know, that are connected to, that can be automated and are very good for performance in front-end. First of them is autoprefixer, which will let you not worry about vendor prefixes, which is still a problem for front-end processes. You don't have to check can I use.com. It will simply pull the information from there and auto-prefix all the CSS properties for you. And the link underneath is actually the name of GitHub organization or user and the name of repository if you want to look it up. Another thing that you probably want to do is CSS linting. CSS Lint was written by Nicole Sullivan, who runs CSSConf US, and Nicola Zakas, and it checks for error notice patterns and possible markup errors in your CSS, which is a good guideline, but I don't feel like it's necessarily a very hard guideline for anyone. It's a preferential guideline, I would say. Another topic is media optimization, so stripping unnecessary bytes from images and vector graphics. A good way to start with that is actually check what's hindering your performance, which can be done with a command line tool that Adios Mani wrote that's called TMI. And after doing that, there are really good two tools that I use all the time, which is called SVGO and ImageOptim. Both of those have command line tools and also interfaces. And they are very good for optimizing images and vector graphics as well. Since we talked about minifying images and graphics, we should also mention minifying code. There are many alternatives present. These are possibly one of the most popular clean CSS and Node CSS min that are based on the UI compressor and will strip unnecessary bytes and characters from CSS. And since we are usually focusing on teamwork, but also that can be introduced in projects that you're handling yourself, we can have a code bloat, which is usually unused declarations that we forgot to remove, or we were busy, or whatever else reason. There are two really great tools that are very helpful with finding unused selectors, which is UnCSS and Helium CSS. It's not very easy as it was with the previous tools to automate using those tools, because they have a lot of options and you need to be very careful about not removing necessary style. So they were queried the DOM for selectors checking against the style sheet. And it will highlight unmatched selectors for you. And then I want to shift a little bit to tools that are not necessarily, they can be really very, like, you know, like you run it in a command line. You actually need to like look at them visually and spend some time interpreting the results. But I feel like the overall, you can get a lot of time saved if you're using them. The first one is called PerfMap, and the other one is called Stress CSS. PerfMap will basically analyze your website and apply overlays over all inline images and graphics and tell you whether they're green, which means they're performant, and orange, and then respectively red for bad performance. So it will show a visual heat map of your site in terms of loading and performance. And Stress CSS will check which classes are badly affecting your performance, so you can debug which CSS property is really bad for you. And then you can use such tools as YSLOW, Chrome Developer Tools Audit, or Google Page Speed for further analyzing performance. And they will give you very detailed tips about fixing your performance. These are not, again, not very automatic, as in like you actually have to run it by hand and just read the results. But it can improve your workflow significantly. And then one of the last things that I wanted to mention in terms of tooling specifically is debugging layout issues with Pesticide.io, which was written by Adam Morse. It's one of the simplest things that I've ever seen, but it can save you so much time. It will basically outline all the elements on your website with different colors, so you can debug layout problems such as floats and lack of proper clearing and box model in general. And then if we're talking about automation, you don't have to rely on command line tools, because all of those tools were command line or such as Pesticide, that's a Chrome app. You can also have UIs for automation, which is Hammer for Mac, CodeKit, Live Reload, and there are plenty of others that will basically offer you a little bit stripped amount of features, which is usually just compilation, watching, running the server, minification of the files, and sometimes image optimization. So these are very basic tools for performance and automating front-end processes that can make significant difference for you and your team. But another very interesting and important topic to raise when we're talking about it is how we include them in the stack. So for me, one of the most straightforward ways of running automation scripts is using NPM. I mostly work in Node environments, so that's kind of like a very obvious choice for me. NPM run start and NPM run test possibly are very frequently in our tool belt, but also some people forget that you can simply define them in package.json along with your dependencies and run your automation test like that. NPM provides a native ecosystem for task automation. And if you think about NPM and say, oh, but NPM is just for JavaScript, that is not true. It might feel that way, but I was always very comfortable with using it as a tool for front-end as well. And I've been actually talking to Isaac about making NPM more accessible for front-end developers, and that's something that they have on their roadmap for NPM for 2015. And as they've written in a very recent article, NPM and front-end packaging, the current support in NPM for front-end packaging isn't good enough. NPM loves you front-enders, and we care about your use cases. So NPM can and will be used by front-end people more and more for automating processes. This is a very simple snippet of how you can include automation of front-end processes in just package.json. So you define scripts, and it's an example from a LevelDB website, and it's just a part of it. So the first one is start, which is basically starts the server and watches for style changes in stylus and changes in templating in Jade, which are defined after start, so watch styles and watch Jade. You can have multiple types of comments. You can pipe the output from one task to another. You can run a comment after the previous one is completed, and you can have concurrency as pictured in the start comment as well. So if you want to look at how automating front-end and running automation tasks in NPM works through package.json, you should read Substack article on NPM task automation, which is the second link. And the first link is the full LevelDB example that was pictured on the previous slide. Another way for automating front-end processes is obviously both grunt and gulp that are really alternatives to something that's like way older, that's called make. And they don't not only rely on specifying dependencies in package.json, but also rely on creating recipe files called grunt file or gulp file JS. Both have very lively communities. They're well-maintained projects. Of course, there's an ongoing discussion whether gulp is better or grunt is better, which, in my opinion, again, ends up being a preferential choice for your stack and your own set of needs and preferences. Gulp may be a little bit better for people who are Node or JavaScript oriented because it's written with streams and it's a little bit faster. And it aligns very well with modular Unix philosophies. So I feel like for Node people, that might be a better preferential choice. While grunt is more popular in Ruby communities, it's a little bit more verbose in terms of setup. But it's also very good. So it ends up being a preferential choice. And if you've never seen how gulp and grunt, they're really similar. So I just picked gulp because it's easier to include in the slides. And shorter. So this basically pulls up gulp and JS hand module for gulp and defines a test task for testing JavaScript file with JS hand. So it looks pretty straightforward. And then as I've mentioned, there's another tool called make, and it's actually something that we're using at Endia as our custom setup. So we're using a make file and a module that Philip Roberts wrote that's called building static server. Which is in a way equivalent for HTTP server module in NPM if you're familiar with that. So it will basically run a server, run a server and watch the file for changes and rerun builds and manage live reloading with live reload extension and make sure you don't see old changes if you refresh while the build is still running. And that's a very short except from our makefile, which basically minifies CSS and will compile stylus from CSS. And the reason why we're not using make on its own is because it's not really great with handling long running processes such as server. So we built static server, so we're using that along with make. Of course, and again, it's a preferential choice for us. And it works for our team and our use cases, but I felt like maybe that's something that you would like to choose and you would like to explore as an option. So if you're interested in that, you can see the building static server at this link on GitHub. So if you're thinking about, we thought about how what tools we can include, how we can include them, but the question is like, when actually are we running those tasks? So usually when you look at open source projects, people are committing minified files upstream directly to GitHub, which is fine, and for smaller projects, yes, why not? But when you're starting working on a team, it becomes quite obvious that you shouldn't be really committed, you know, minified CSS to a repo, because it easily will create very nasty merge conflicts. And if you're very familiar with Git, that's fine. Like you can resolve them very easily. But on the other hand, it also has the assumption that every single person that's committing to the repository is able to run a build, which is a pretty big assumption to make. Because you also have a marketing person, you might have a person that's just writing copy, and they also want to contribute, but they can't necessarily because they have to have, you know, like setting up build environment. And that's not necessary too for all of them. So maybe the optimization that you want to do, minification of images and code as well, should be happening pre-deploy and should be handled by the DevOps team instead. So that brings us to the topic of collaboration and empowerment. So the bottom line of all of this tooling that we've mentioned and all of the process that we can choose for ourselves is that we have to empower ourselves, but also our team to build better and faster. And the starting point for that is not the choice of technology at all. It's actually collaboration. And one of the key ingredients for teamwork is getting rid of our egos and putting the good of our team before our preferential choices. Because that often means negotiating the set of tools that are our favorite ones, but they need to be easy to use and very straightforward and very easy to understand for the entire team, not only for ourselves. Technology is a mean to an end, and it will fail miserably if people can't work together, feel empowered to contribute and grow. Every single person joins a team with their own set of preferences, predispositions, and biases. We're all different, but collaboration happens when these preferences will not cloud reasonable judgment and decisions about what is best for the entire team. Because what's good for me as a person doesn't necessarily imply that it will work out for a group. And one of the most important ingredients is transparent process. We really, as a rule, we despise formalities and we don't want to have too much information to digest. We don't really want to have a lot of documentation. But on the other hand, documentation is crucial for implementing good collaboration and automation as well. Because if you imagine that you're supposed to write good tools for your front end and implement some rules for your team to follow, imagine the overhead of explaining that process of automating front end to every single person of your team. Let's say that you have 15 people and you will spend 30 minutes of every single person, that's an entire day of your work, just spend explaining. That feels kind of wrong to me. So you should be documenting your processes as people do in open source software. Why should we only write good documentation because it's public facing? We should also write it because it's for our team to use. And knowledge makes everything simpler. So people will feel more empowered to do stuff on their own and, you know, create new projects and start up new projects if we have good documentation. Another thing that also follows Unix philosophy and Node philosophy as well, which is breaking down in modules because it makes it more digestible and controllable. Modules are easier to deal with, especially if one module is handling only one, is responsible for only one thing and does it really well. That makes it very easy to pull out features, add features, and makes things very easy to debug. We often hear that, oh, this library is so big, it's so monadic, it's so awful, I can't even work with this. And the reason is not necessarily either technical debt or code bloat. Sometimes it's just bad organization and lack of proper structure. And since we were talking about a lot of command line tools, good tools, especially command line based, do not fail or succeed silently. Seventh failure prevents people who are especially less command line savvy or less, just starting their development careers. That prevents them from debugging and makes them very confused, and they can't really collaborate or contribute that much. So making sure that our automation tools are very vocal about both success and failure is very important. And you might think that, oh, well, communicating failure is fine, but success, like, that's, I don't know, that may be too much. Then maybe you should think about allowing people to disable notifications for success if they are feeling comfortable with that. The aim for building bulletproof software is profound but almost impossible to achieve. And I feel like we often forget about it. Our work is never done, and progress is another constant along with complexity. But in a way, we can anticipate user behavior and user input, especially if we are thinking about tooling. So when we are introducing new tools, especially in the command line, it's very important to make sure that you don't accept erroneous input or at least communicate that someone is doing something wrong. It's relatively easy to build overcomplicated solutions, but it's hard to maintain them. We all strive for perfection and being super clever. Unfortunately, over-engineering usually results with more time wasted and doesn't necessarily empower us and our teams as well. There's a lot of preaching about shipping cultures and the importance of just cranking code, and certainly that's there's a grain of truth in it, but and tooling is very important in doing so, but it also has to be done right. But right doesn't necessarily mean very clever or sophisticated. It just means it works and my team understands it and knows how to use it. It's easy to introduce unnecessary complexity by adding tools that manage other tools. If we think about packages, and all the tools that we mentioned are packages on NPM or somewhere else, we have the problem of package manager. There are many package managers that can be used in the front end, which is NPM, as we mentioned, Bower, Component, and many more. So how do we pick which one is good for us? In Node environment, people are sometimes, front-end people are afraid of NPM because it's dubbed as the JavaScript package manager, so it's like not, we shouldn't be putting front-end here because people will get mad, which is not true. So then we might fall back to Bower or Component. But then, if you think about it, that might really quickly escalate to brew install Python, easy install pip, install Bower, install npm, install -g, fuck you, which is actually a module, so it's not just me swearing. So the presence of those package manager is great. There's npm, Bower, Component, and they all have different architectures. They have different different use cases, and they're all great. But you need to be very careful while introducing those, because you might very easily end up doing a lot of additional work that shouldn't be done. And you need to be very aware of dependencies that you're introducing, technical depth or technical advancement that it will bring in. The right set of tools, or lack thereof, sets apart a craftsman from an operator. So if we're thinking about front-end technologies that are advancing very, very fast, and as we established earlier, we can't really keep up with everything. What sets apart a good front-end developer or just software engineer, anyone that's doing code or design, is the right set of tools. I'm not saying that you should not be using 20 tools or 40 because that's too much. There's no arbitrary number that's perfect and you should be using less than X number. But you should be very careful about introducing them, and you should be considerate about people who will be collaborating on the project that you're working on. Which brings me to a video that I want you to watch. The reason for playing this video is that I want you all to remember that collaboration is far more important than actual choice of technology. And I want you to be inspired by this video, hopefully. And I want you to remember the human side technology that's way more important than that technology itself. And I hope that this will set a theme for you for learning for this entire day of amazing talks, and that maybe it will prompt you to be a better human to yourself and your teammates as well, and maybe redefine your processes when you're learning amazing stuff about CSS for the entire day. So thank you.
Awesome.